and lead us toward your people. Use our feet.
Okay. Stephen, come on up, brother. So we're kind of winging it today without Pastor Tim here, but I love you, brother.
Love you too. Oh, man.
This is, who was I talking to? I think it was Harry. And I said, yep, we're going to be launching Stephen today out on his own. And he said, yeah, there's going to be a lot of tears. There's going to be a lot of handkerchiefs. But you know what? This is a joyous occasion. This is an absolutely joyous occasion. And we in our fleshliness, we did everything we could to try to keep Stephen here. We went to lunch at Fisherman's on Friday, and Danny put a little, Stephen was struggling on this decision, and he says, I'm just waiting to hear from God. And so Danny gave a little note to the waitress and said, put this in Stephen's food. And it was a little note that said, don't take the job. The sad part was Stephen ate the note. No. just kidding. Oh, praise the Lord. Okay, so we have a little video. Is your wife here this? Yeah?
No, she's at home.
Okay.
With the kids. She's not feeling too well.
Okay. Oh, bless her heart. Lord, heal her.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. So we have a little video that we're going to show of just some of the things that have gone on since Stephen arrived here. So do we have that ready, Al?
You're willing to fight.
That was beautiful. Okay, at this time, I want to ask the deacons and staff to come up. And we're going to pray over Stephen. So though I believe the way we need to look at this as a church is that we're launching Stephen into the mission field. And when they sent out Paul and Barnabas from the church in Antioch, they said it seemed good to us and to the Holy Spirit to send them out. And that's the situation here. We've prayed over Stephen a lot, and like I said, in our flesh, we want to cling to people we love, but this is a good thing. And I do want to say, if you feel that the Lord is leading you to join Stephen out there in Hayden at the Family Worship Center, if the Lord is prompting you to do that, that is perfectly fine. Come and talk to us about it. We will pray with you. We don't want to send him out alone. If you feel led to do that, it's kind of like a church plant in a way. And that's a beautiful thing. We've dreamed of this for years and years. I kind of thought it would be Danny and Carissa that would be the first to go out, but the Lord had a different plan. And so we're sending Stephen and Christina and their beautiful children out. And so this is a joyous thing, and we just want to pray for Stephen and send him out with our blessing. And I think we might have Pastor Tim. Can't get a connection? Okay. Oh, hi there. You came up on my blind side. So, Adela has put together this beautiful plaque, and it's a certificate of faithfulness. It has a very powerful scripture on it, and not many people understand this scripture, but I don't have my glasses on, so I can't read it, but it says, those who are faithful in the little things will be entrusted with greater things. And beyond a shadow of a doubt, Stephen, you have been faithful in the little things. The tiniest of tasks you were faithful with. And the Lord entrusted you with greater tasks, and you were faithful with those. You poured yourself into them, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, you have been exhibiting a fruitful life. Praise the Lord. We see the fruit of your life. And so we feel very confident that as we send you off, the Lord's going to continue to give you fruitfulness.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Though we're sad to see you go, we are so thankful that the Lord's going to continue to use you in this new capacity as a senior pastor of a little fledgling church.
Amen.
But it's a start, brother.
For God's vision.
Amen. Okay. Lord bless you with that. Let's gather around and pray for Stephen. Yes, if you would stand, that's great. Hallelujah. Lord, thank you so much for our dear brother Stephen, Lord. We've watched him grow. He got saved right here on these steps. And Lord, he thought his whole life was wound up in being in gangs and being in prison. And then you stepped in, Lord. Your redemptive power transformed this young man. And Lord, you are giving him an abundant life as he continues to serve you. You are giving him an abundant life, a beautiful wife, beautiful children, a beautiful church. And now, Lord, there's a new chapter in Stephen's life. And Lord, it's kind of sad for us because he won't be serving here as much, but we're very connected to that little church. And so we know we're going to be very involved in what Stephen is doing out there. And so, Lord, we pray a blessing upon Stephen and that precious little church that's out there right now. I know many of the members, and they are so excited to have Stephen coming to minister to them. So, Lord, we give Stephen, our utmost blessing and encouragement. And we willingly release Stephen to do this ministry, knowing that you've called him to do it. It is your will, Lord, and we thank you and praise you for what you're doing in our midst, Lord. We do have some holes in this ministry because of Stephen leaving, but Lord, we know you have a plan for that too.
Yes, Lord.
I pray that you just fill those slots. Those are big shoes that Stephen filled, and we got to find someone to step into those places, Lord. So we pray that you would help us to find just the right one, the one you've handpicked,
yes,
to do that, Lord. We put it in your loving and faithful hands and just thank you and praise you for your goodness and mercy and the fruitfulness you've allowed us to have because we choose to stay grafted to the vine,
yes,
which is Jesus Christ. We pray these things in his wonderful name. Amen. Amen.
I love you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Church. I love you guys very much. And this isn't the end. This is only the beginning. And I really truly believe, and we're able to see this, that this is what God has ordained to take place, the Great Commission being fulfilled right here in our own little church. And that's special. And I know that not only the staff and the leadership here at the church, but all of us should be so proud of what's taking place here. And I thank you so much for your support and your encouragement in fulfilling this great commission. There's souls that need to be saved. There's God's love that needs to be preached, and people have to know that there is a God that loves them and wants to have peace with them. Amen? Amen. So I'm excited. It's only the beginning. We're going to go ahead and we're going to open up in prayer and dive right into the message this morning. I could go on and on about how much I love you guys and I'm going to miss you guys, but let's be about the Father's business and get into what he has for us this morning. Lord, we approach your throne of grace with boldness, Lord, thanking you, God, that you're here to give us help in time of need. The way that things are going in the world, God, you know. It's crazy. We need to rely on you, Jesus. We need to depend on you, and we need to be equipped to be able to face what lies ahead of us. And so, God, this morning I pray that you anoint this message, that it breaks forth, and that it is able to equip your church, that it is able to strengthen us, God, in our most holy faith, that we may be able to accomplish what you have called us to do. Help us, Lord. If there's any of us in this room this morning that is lacking the understanding of who you are and has yet to accept you, to be delivered from the throes of this world and the bondage of sin, I pray that today is the day of salvation. I pray that this message hits them home directly. They're able to own the gospel and take it personal and know that you love them so much that you sent your only begotten Son, that they should not perish and be condemned, but that they should be saved and set free. I pray that you open the eyes of the blind this morning. And I pray that you equip your church to be able to accomplish your will while we still have breath here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen. So every Sunday morning, our pastor has been on the topic of politics. It's a huge topic of conversation today in our world, and Pastor has been very passionate about this topic because he feels the warning of the Holy Spirit of what's coming down the pike, of what's coming in future events. Some people are saying that he is becoming too political, that this is church, and he just needs to stick to the Bible. Well, first and foremost, Pastor Tim is a man of God. And yes, he's a preacher. But if he couldn't preach, he'd still be a man of God. In whatever realm that the Lord had called him to minister in, whether it's as a legislature, whether it's as a preacher, whatever it would be, he would be a man of God, and he would bring God's glory into it. And so we have to understand something. When it comes to this unction that I know that our senior pastor, Pastor Tim, has been given, we are now coming to a time in history where biblical prophecy and the political climate we are currently in are converging into the last days right before our eyes. We must know that the Bible says when the Antichrist shows up, he will be a great political figure with great political power and is going to use the one world government to wage war against everything and anyone that represents the one true God. No one will be able to buy, sell, or trade unless they take his mark and unless they worship him. In the last days, it is the government that will come against God's people. We have to understand that. The culture, the law of man, society itself will all be given over to a strong delusion that they might believe a lie because they refused to love the truth. The government and the rest of the world will be deceived into believing that persecuting Christians is actually a good and noble thing. These are things that the Bible speaks of. They will be given over to that delusion, and they're going to be thinking that they're doing their God, whatever that may be, service by doing it. Huge levels of this has been and is taking place all over the world today. That strong delusion is already at work. The spirit of Antichrist is already here, and it's getting stronger. This last Thursday night, our president spoke at a Republican National Convention. I want you to take heed to a truthful and profound statement he made. Donald Trump said this, quote, "This is the most important election in the history of our country. At no time before have voters faced a clearer choice between two parties, two visions, two philosophies, or two agendas. This election will decide if we save the American dream or whether we allow a socialistic agenda to demolish our cherished destiny." It's clear to everyone, church, that there is a complete polar opposites when it comes to this election year. You must vote for an Antichrist agenda or biblical principle. There's no in between. There is no way a true Christian can go against their biblical convictions and vote Democratic. Condoning the slaughter of unborn babies, homosexual marriage, and the transgender agenda, all of this is the push towards a reprobate mind that Romans 1 talks about. If the Democratic Party wins this election, it will escalate the push towards the world being united under the spirit of error and even closer to ushering in the Antichrist. But church, there's still souls that need to be saved. This is why we, as the church, must be built up in our most holy faith, that we are unmovable when it comes to the persecution that is inevitably going to take place. Recently, Pastor Tim has been in Matthew 24 going over the words of Jesus concerning the last days. Some of the most valuable exhortations are given from Christ here, such as Matthew 24, verses 12 and 13. It says, "And because iniquity shall abound, iniquity, lawlessness, rebellion shall run rampant, the love of many shall wax cold." In other words, people will have a convoluted and distorted perspective of what real love actually is. They'll think that love is tolerance of sin. They'll think that love is condoning homosexual marriage. They'll think that love is giving women free choice to kill their unborn babies. That's not love. The love, the true love of many will wax cold. But the word here says, He that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And so you see that this endurance is essential. The Apostle Paul put it like this in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. He says, "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has called him to be a soldier." Last week, we heard a testimony of endurance from our dear brother Michael Paul, who the Lord sustained through severe persecution. But I believe that a key component of Michael Paul's ability to endure that hardness was an attitude of complete commitment to Jesus Christ. That's what helped sustain Michael Paul through everything he was appointed to face. Church, that type of endurance is only given by the power of the Holy Spirit. All of us have the power to choose what type of attitude we are going to have through suffering. Suffering is actually at the heart of our Christian faith. Jesus said, "If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you." The Apostle Paul put it like this. He gave us a promise. He said, everyone who lives godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. The Israelite people wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, having a bad, ungrateful attitude. That attitude that they chose kept them there in the wilderness for that 40 years. I don't know if many of you know this, but what was supposed to take 11 days, 11-day journey from crossing the Red Sea to the Promised Land, took 40 years. Man. So you see that what attitude that you're going to choose in life is going to determine how long you spend in the wildernesses. This morning, we are going to take a look at what the Apostle Peter tells us on how to possess an attitude of commitment to Christ that will produce the endurance we need in these last days. I want you to open up your Bibles with me to 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4. The purpose of this letter was to teach the church how to live victoriously in the midst of horrific suffering and persecution. It is recorded that on the night of July 18th in 64 AD, a fire broke out and swept across Rome, ravaging the city for 6 days. It would be known as the Great Fire of Rome. When the city of Rome burned, the Romans believed that their emperor, Nero, had set the city on fire. The Romans were totally devastated. Their culture went down with the city. All the religious elements of their life were destroyed. Their great temples, shrines, and even their household idols were all burnt up. Many had been killed. Their bitter resentment was severe, so Nero realized that he had to redirect the hostility. The emperor's chosen scapegoat was the Christians, who were already hated because they were associated with the Jews. And because they were seen as being hostile to the Roman culture itself, Nero spread the word quickly that the Christians had set the fires. As a result, a vicious persecution against Christians began and soon spread throughout the entire Roman Empire. There were things known as Nero's Circus of Imperial Games, where they would capture Christians, men, women, children alike, and let them loose in this arena, and then they would let lions loose that hadn't eaten for 3 days to rip them to shreds. That's just one example of the persecution that Christians faced as Paul writes this letter to the church. It's important to know that suffering in life is inevitable. In the previous chapter, Peter says that you will either suffer for your own foolish decisions or for righteousness' sake to the glory of God. It's our decision, but you will suffer. In the secular world, suffering is never seen as a meaningful part of life, but only as an interruption. And that's because suffering is unbearable if you aren't certain that God is with you if you don't know that God is for you. Satan can actually use suffering to bully you, into giving in to sin because of the fear of suffering. The question is not whether you are in a battle or not. All of us are in a battle. The question is whether you're going to fight, whether you're going to arm yourselves, or whether you're not. So let's take a look at our passage here. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. Peter says here to us right now, "For as much then as Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God." Amen. Peter here tells us to arm ourselves. It alludes to this idea of taking up weaponry so that we can fight victoriously and overcome as Christ calls us to. We know that the weapons that are available to us are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. This idea of arming ourselves is the sole focus of this entire passage, how to equip us for what's to come. I truly believe that persecution is coming swiftly to the American church, and it's going to come even swifter if the Republican Party does not win this election. Now, Peter says here, "For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, that we need to arm ourselves likewise with the same mind, the mind of Christ." Are you willing to suffer well? Is there a willingness to suffer through trial and persecution and come out on the other side having a shining testimony to those around you? A big reason why people in the church aren't willing to suffer is because they have yet to understand, they have yet to take personal for themselves the sufferings of Christ on their behalf. The God who loves us, coming and dying on our behalf, is the most important event in the history of the world. There is nothing in this world that is more purposeful, nothing in this world that is more meaningful than Christ on the cross. The ending of Jesus Christ's life on the cross is the beginning of our lives for all eternity. The cross was chosen to be the symbol for the Christian faith by the early church, which is very interesting because it is an emblem, a symbol of suffering and shame, not the kind of thing you would use to adorn your homes as a piece of art or wear around your neck as a necklace. Crucifixion was torturous, shameful, and the most painful way to die. Jewish and Greek historians have said that it is the most wretched way to die, and that the Roman citizens shouldn't even speak of the cross because it was so unfit to even think of that kind of death. All that were sentenced to death on a cross were considered cursed of God, so much so that a word was invented to describe crucifixion. The word excruciating literally means from the cross. Those who were crucified died by painfully slow, excruciating death by asphyxiation. When someone is crucified, their body is slouching so much so that as the air is exhaled from their body, from their lungs, they struggle to breathe again. The result is that they would then push themselves up by their nailed feet to inhale, thereby extending their life. They would pass in and out of consciousness. Now, this would take place for hours or even days as they bake in the heat of the sun, as they freeze under the cool of night. Some, in an effort to hasten their death, would slouch on the cross, seeking to die as quickly as possible. And the whole point was to make someone suffer as long as the body could endure. It is accompanied with dehydration, blood loss, shock, and the person very slowly and very shamefully dies. This was something not done in a private place either. It was done on the side of the road, on the side of the highway, right by the marketplaces. Now, church, I'm not telling you these things to be overdramatic, but so that you may understand the reality of the cross, knowing that not so many Christians have envisioned the suffering that took place for their behalf. The Bible says that before Jesus was crucified, that he went through a process called scourging. A Roman scourging was a sentence in and of itself for criminals of that day. It was so brutal that many that underwent this scourging would die from the scourging alone. Scourging would occur when a man would be stripped of his clothes, often naked, and his hands would be shackled above his head around a pole. He was then laid out so his back, his shoulders, buttocks, and legs were exposed. And an executioner would take what is called a cat of nine tails. It was a handle from which proceeded straps of leather, and at the end of each strap of leather, there would be a metal ball or a hook made out of bone or metal. The executioner would whip the prisoner across the back. The metal balls would serve to tenderize the flesh of the prisoner like a steak. The hooks would then sink into the man's body. The executioner would then give a tug upon the cat of nine tails and literally rip the flesh off of the man's body. The church historian Eusebius of Caesarea recounts this horrible detail in a scene of scourging. He was one of John the Beloved's disciples. He says this, "For they say that the bystanders were struck with amazement when they saw them lacerated with scourges, even to the innermost veins and arteries, so that the inward parts of the body, both their bowels and their members, were all exposed." It was tradition that when a criminal was scourged, that they would shout out their crime in confession as they were being scourged. Jesus was repeatedly scourged. His bone shook, and his muscle was torn. His flesh was removed, but he remained silent. As a sheep before her shears is dumb, he opened not his mouth. He went into shock, his body covered in blood. He was in excruciating agony. In Isaiah 52, the prophet foresees the image of Christ. It speaks of Jesus' suffering that everyone who saw him was so horrified because he suffered until he no longer looked human, that he was unrecognizable to those who knew him. The Bible then records that a crown of thorns was placed upon Jesus' head in mockery of him. Jesus was then forced to carry his own crossbar to his place of execution. This crossbar would have weighed close to 100 pounds. He needed assistance to carry it to his own murder. Upon arriving to his place of crucifixion, Jesus was laid upon the cross, had nails driven through the most sensitive points in his body, through his hands and his feet. The cross was then raised up and dropped violently into a post hole so that his entire body shook upon the nails. At this point, he is bleeding. He is suffering. And I can just see him opening up his eyes to gaze upon the crowd that is before him. He sees his enemies. He sees those who brought false witness against him. He sees his disciples who left him, abandoned him, and betrayed him. Then he looks up to heaven and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." At this point in time, darkness covers the land for 3 hours as Jesus hangs upon that cross. And our Lord and Savior yells out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He screams it. And at that very time, the most excruciating pain that Christ could have ever gone through takes place, where the Father forsakes his Son for your sake and for my sake. You see, church, the Bible is the lone voice that declares that all of humanity has been separated from God because of our sin, and that there is only one way to be restored to him. The only way that can happen is if someone takes our place, if someone takes the punishment that you and I rightly deserve. We all are in need of the Savior. We all need someone to stand in the gap and be a substitution. You see, church, that the essence of sin itself is us standing in a place, substituting ourselves for God. Standing in a place in our life where God should be, saying, "I got this. I'll figure it out on my own. I don't need your help, God. I got this." That's the very essence of sin itself. And so you see, the essence of salvation is God substituting himself for us, standing in the place where we should be. That is salvation. Taking the penalty that we all rightly deserve. You see, to be right with God, there had to be this great exchange that took place, where God the Father treated his Son like you and I rightly deserve to be treated, so he could treat us like Jesus deserves to be treated. Paul put it like this. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, "For he hath made him sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Understanding Christ's suffering and purpose for that suffering on the cross arms us with the courage and boldness to go through whatever suffering we are appointed to, because we are confident that God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son to stand in the place of judgment that we should be. That love that wells up inside of you compels you to face whatever must be faced. And if you don't understand that, if you don't keep that and know that, you're not going to endure. You see, our brothers and sisters overseas that deal with severe persecution, the images that Pastor Tim showed on the screen of men tied with their hands behind the back, on their knees, guns pointed to their heads, guns pointed to the heads of babies, all of those things, what keeps those people from denying Christ isn't this muster of their own love for God. It's not that. It's that they know without a shadow of a doubt the suffering of Christ for their sake, and that God loves them. That's what keeps them from denying Christ. That's what's going to keep us from denying Christ. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 and 9 say this: "Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him." You guys, if Christ himself here on earth had to learn obedience through suffering, What makes us think that somehow we're going to be exempt? We must take the same attitude of determination that Christ had when it comes to executing our Father's commandments. I want you to look at the second part of our text here in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. The second part here says, For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. What Peter is saying here is that when there is this determination in your mind, when there is this willingness that has been embraced to go through suffering for the sake of Christ, there becomes this break from the power of sin upon your life, that it will no longer have dominion over you. It's important that you understand this principle. What empowers sin in your life is the fear of suffering. What empowers sin in our lives is the fear of suffering. Think about how much ground sin gains in your life because you're afraid to suffer. Some are afraid to suffer financially, so they're dishonest with their taxes. Or they receive benefits that they know that if they were really honest about their income and how much they made, they wouldn't get those benefits. And so they're dishonest. Others are afraid to suffer in their relationships, so they would rather commit fornication and please their boyfriend or girlfriend and themselves, all because they don't want to suffer. They would rather be disobedient to the word of God. Some are afraid to embrace the suffering that comes with real repentance, so they escape through alcohol, drugs, perversion, anything to check out and not have to face what they have to face. So you see, we must come to a place where we are willing to suffer before we are willing to sin. You have to count the cost on what it truly means to follow Christ. That narrow road is marked with pain and suffering. When we are willing to suffer, it is a devastating blow to the power of sin in our lives. Moses embraced this principle, and the author of Hebrews actually highlights it for us. If you'll go to Hebrews chapter 11, look at what it says here, beginning at verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of reward. I pray that we can take on the same committed attitude to be able to go through suffering as Moses did. We see this same attitude of commitment in chapter 5 when the apostles are standing before the council of the Jews and they are reprimanding the apostles for teaching in the name of Jesus. The Jews are up in arms in what to do because they keep arresting them and God keeps letting them go. They're arresting them and then God lets them go. One of the Pharisees in the council stands up and says, if it's not of God, it will come to nothing, but if it's of God, you can't stop it. He says, leave them alone. Let them go. And in verse 40, it says, and to him they agreed, the council agreed. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name. And daily in the temple and in every house, they ceased not to teach and to preach Jesus. You know why the apostles could continue to teach and preach Jesus? Because they weren't afraid of suffering for his name. and so they could commit to the will of God for their lives. As we look at our examples of faith in Scripture, we see that they saw great value in suffering that enabled them not only to endure, but to rejoice in the midst of that suffering. And because of that attitude of commitment, they no longer would live the rest of their time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but they were enabled, equipped, empowered to follow through and execute the will of God in their lives. They saw, just as Jesus did, of what lies beyond the suffering, the glory that shall be revealed. In Jesus' humanity, if he just looked at the cross, if he just looked at the suffering as an end, then it would be very, very, very hard for him to have gone through it. If the disciples looked at the crosses that they had to bear, the persecution and the suffering, and that was it, they looked at it as an end, then it probably would have been impossible for them to go through it. But they were able to envision what lies beyond the cross. They were able to envision what lies ahead of them, that the sufferings of this life are nothing to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed, that this is just temporal. And to be coming from men that had to go through that type of pain, coming from men that tradition says that as they hung upon the cross, they preached to their tormentors until they killed them, obviously they had an understanding of the great love that God had for them and the suffering that Jesus himself went through, and they considered it an honor to go through the same. Would you consider it an honor to go through the same? I believe that there's some of us that have been limited from the will of God in our life because of our fear of suffering. There's some of us who are entangled in sin because of our fear of suffering without committing that sin. Whether it's in our business, financially, relationally, it's so important that you're able to have that clean break. And to be able to do that, you must know and understand and own what Christ has done for you personally. Church, we're now going to participate in communion. If we can have our pastors and deacons come forward to be able to help distribute the communion. I think that this message on the sufferings and afflictions of Christ and his great love for us is very timely to be able to participate in remembering Christ and the sacrifice that he truly made for our sins. I didn't plan this, actually. I had this message before Ken and Connie and Danny told me that we were going to participate in this. And so as we begin to pass out communion, can we have a little bit of music played lightly? Oh, there he is. He's quick. He does it to Pastor, too.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. worthy is your name, Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I'll bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. 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 Worthy is your name. Worthy is your draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else could take your place. to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find my way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near.
What we hold in our hands is a symbolic representation for us to be stirred up by remembrance of the great sacrifice that was made for us by our Lord and Savior. The same night that Jesus was betrayed, he sat at the Last Supper with his disciples, knowing that he came from God and was going back to God. He looks around the room and he takes a piece of bread and he shows his disciples and he says, "This bread is my body, which was broken for you. And this cup is my blood, which is the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of our sins." Amen. And so as we sit here together this morning, we get to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of God, which passes what somebody could teach us, because we experience it and God Himself has revealed it to us. Amen. So I pray that you will just take a moment and remember when God parted the Red Seas for you, when God's forgiveness showed up, when His mercy came running for you. Yes. Lord, we thank you for your body, your brutally mutilated body that was broken on our behalf. And as we take this bread, Lord, we remember you, yes, your sacrifice and your resurrection, and that one day you're coming back for us, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Let us partake of the bread. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for the hope of the new covenant, which was sealed by the spilling of your innocent, precious, and perfect blood. And as we partake in this cup, Lord, we remember your forgiveness that was shed on the cross at Calvary. We remember that we have been redeemed and sealed by the Holy Spirit, and will wait your return, Lord, because we know that it is very soon. And so help us to be ready together as your church. In Jesus' name, let's partake of the blood. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're in this together, church. We're one body. Amen. And no matter what house of faith or fellowship that you attend, when the Spirit of God is in a brother or sister, there's a unification there that goes beyond what this world can try to throw asunder. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Amen. I pray that today you go in peace and you remember the sufferings of Christ. And you remember that you have been appointed to suffer for his name's sake.
Amen.
And so let us do it joyfully and be an astounding testimony to the world around us.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, church. Love you too.